isolation of zinc and aluminium. And let us continue the same with isolation of copper. Yesterday also we had started this one. Let us see from the beginning. That is isolation of copper. So as we said earlier, in every isolation of the metal, we are having four steps. That is selection of the ore, then concentration of the ore, extraction of the crude metal, and refining of that crude metal to pure metal. So when we are seeing about the ores of copper, we are having copper pyrites, whose formula is CuFeS2, malachite, CuCO3, CuOH twice, cuprite, Cu2O, and copper glands, Cu2S. In this, we are going to extract or isolate copper metal from copper pyrites. Copper pyrite's formula is CuFeS2. So since it is a sulfide ore, it is being concentrated by a process called as froth flotation process. In this froth flotation process, powdered ore is mixed with water, pine oil, and it is agitated such that gangue particles are associated with water and settle down, whereas the sulfide ore particles combine with pine oil. The ore particles adsorb over the surface of froth of oil and form the froth, which is separated, heated, such that oil is evaporated, leaving out the ore. From that concentrated ore, we are going to extract the crude metal. So, since it is a sulfide ore, we are seeing that it is roasted such that whatever arsenic impurities, antimony impurities present in it are converted into their volatile oxides and leaving the reverberatory furnace. So the copper pyrites, concentrated copper pyrites, is roasted such that we are removing the unwanted impurities in the form of volatile oxides. And the copper pyrites react with oxygen in roasting process, that is burned in the presence of oxygen, to produce cuprous sulfide, ferrous sulfide, and sulfur dioxide. Sulfur dioxide is a gas which is left out. Now, the cuprous sulfide formed is the cuprous sulfide and iron sulfide formed are further oxidized into their oxides. You can see the reactions here. Ferrous sulfide is roasted to produce a ferrous oxide and sulfur dioxide. Cuprous sulfide is also oxidized to see that it is producing cuprous oxide. And sulfur dioxide is a gas, it moves out. If any arsenic and antimony impurities are present, they are converted into their volatile oxides and they are removed. Now, conversion of cuprous oxide into crude metal. In this, we are using pyrometallurgy, that is smelting process, to convert cuprous oxide into crude copper metal. In the smelting of cuprous oxide, it is done in a reverberatory furnace. The main impurity present in the roasted ore is ferrous oxide and traces of ferrous sulfide. Conversion of cuprous oxide into crude metal, it is done in a reverberatory furnace. In the reverberatory furnace, roasted ore, coke and sand are mixed and it is called as charge. Roasted ore is the main source of copper. Coke is used as fuel as well as the reducing agent. And the sand present, that is the silica, is used as the flux. Cuprous oxide is reduced with carbon, that is coke, to produce copper and carbon monoxide. Cuprous oxide reacts with ferrous sulfide, which is present as the impurity, converts into cuprous sulfide and ferrous oxide. Ferrous oxide reacts with the silica, that is the sand, SiO2, to produce FeSiO3. See here, FeSiO3 formed is the slag. So ferrous oxide is the basic impurity present here in this reverberatory furnace. Silica is used as the flux, which is an acid flux, because ferrous oxide is basic in nature. We are using SiO2, which is an acid flux. And slag is formed. FeSiO3 is the slag formed here. The slag is having less density, so it floats on crude molten metal, which is skimmed off or which is removed. Let us see the process on the screen here. The roasted ore, coke and sand are taken into the reverberatory furnace. The hot air passed into the reverberatory furnace through the tires. As they are heated strongly, we can see that the cuprous oxide is reduced to produce copper. Cuprous oxide may react with ferrous sulfide to produce cuprous sulfide and ferrous oxide. Ferrous oxide being the basic impurity, it is reacting with the acidic flux to produce slag in the form of FeSiO3. The crude metal formed contains copper, cuprous sulfide as one of the impurity, ferrous sulfide as one of the impurity, coke and sand. Here, cuprous sulfide, ferrous sulfide, coke and sand will be the impurities. The copper or crude copper formed here is called as copper mate. This is the copper mate. You can see the picture of copper mate. So copper mate is the crude copper metal which is having impurities of copper sulfide, ferrous sulfide, coke and silica. Now this copper mate, which is the crude copper metal, is subjected to refining by oxidation process, in which we are using bessemerization process. Bessemerization is done in a Bessemer converter. This is the diagram of Bessemer converter. The copper mate is mixed with silica and a blast of hot air is sent into the Bessemer converter. So the blast of hot air is sent through the tires into the Bessemer converter. in which ferrous sulfide, which we are having as impurity, is oxidized to ferrous oxide and sulfur dioxide. And ferrous oxide reacts with the silica to produce slag. Once again, slag is formed here. Cuprous sulfide, which is present as the impurity, is oxidized as cuprous oxide and sulfur dioxide. Here, self-reduction takes place, that is, the cuprous oxide and cuprous sulfide together reacts to produce copper metal. This particular process we had also seen in self-reduction process. So in that way, copper is produced. The slag is skimmed off, that is removed, and the molten metal formed is poured into the sand molds. Such sand molds will be there, sand molds through which sulfur dioxide formed escapes out. As we are saying, we are seeing molten metal formed is poured into the sand molds, such that sulfur dioxide gas present, if any amount of sulfur dioxide present, will be escaping out. This sulfur dioxide, when it is escaping out, it leaves some blisters on the surface of copper. You can see the blisters. These are the blisters on the surface of copper. That is why this particular copper is called as a blister copper. So when coppermate is having impurities of ferrous sulfide, cuprous oxide and silica as the impurities, the coppermate is mixed with the silica, taken into the Bessemer converter. A blast of hot air is sent here, such that ferrous sulfide is oxidized to ferrous oxide. Ferrous oxide is reacting with the silica to produce a slag, FeSiO3. Cuprous sulfide is oxidized to cuprous oxide. Cuprous oxide and cuprous sulfide undergo self-reduction to produce copper. Most of the sulfur dioxide is going out in the form of waste gases. If any amount of sulfur dioxide present with molten copper, we can see that when it is poured into the sand molds, the sulfur dioxide is escaping out, leaving some blisters over the surface of the copper. The bubble-like blisters formed over the copper, due to which it is called as a blister copper. Blister copper is now subjected to refining once again. After the refining with Bessemerization oxidation method, again we are going to go for refining of blister copper. This is done by electro-refining process. In this electro-refining process, you can see that we are taking impure copper as the anode, pure copper as the cathode. Copper sulfate solution is taken as the electrolyte. And this container is the electrolytic cell. So here, you can see that once again that cathode is pure copper, which is thin rod. Anode is impure copper, which is we are taking from blister copper. Electrolyte, we are taking copper sulfate solution. At anode, always you know that oxidation takes place. That is copper, present in the impure copper rod will be converted into Cu+2 ions. That is oxidation takes place by losing two electrons. At a cathode, Cu+2 ions gain electrons to form copper metal. You know that at the cathode only reduction takes place, that is gaining of electrons takes place to produce copper metal. the impurities, whatever impurities present, are settled down at the bottom as anode mud. So this contains, this anode mud contains gold and silver particles also. So this anode mud is further used to extract gold and silver particles. In this process, we are going to get a 99.99% of copper by refining of blister copper. In this way, the blister copper is refined such that we are getting 99.99% of copper. Let us see a quick revision of isolation of copper metal from copper pyrites. We are taking copper pyrites whose formula is CuFeS2. It is a sulfide ore. Since it is a sulfide ore, it is concentrated by froth flotation process to produce concentrated copper pyrites. This concentrated copper pyrites is roasted such that we are going to get cuprous oxide. Cuprous oxide is subjected to smelting, in which we are going to get coppermate. Coppermate is subjected to refining by besmerization process to produce blister copper. In blister copper, we can see that we are having 99% of copper. To see that this 99% of copper is converted into 99.99% of copper, we are subjecting this one for electro-refining. So here we are doing two refining methods. One is besmerization, which is an oxidation process. And the second one, we are using electro-refining process to see that we are getting 99.99% pure copper. So in this way, we can see that we are extracting pure copper from copper pyrites. Let us see the uses of copper now. Copper is used for making wires used in electrical industry. So probably everyone have seen these copper wires. Copper is used for water and steam pipes, or in AC machines also we'll be using copper pipes. Copper is also used in several alloys that are rather tougher than metal itself, like brass. So previously in the uses of zinc also we had seen brass items, which is an alloy of zinc and copper. Bronze, you know that in medals we will be having bronze medal. Bronze is a alloy of copper with tin. Coinage alloys with nickel, when it is combined with nickel, that alloy is called as coinage alloy, which is mostly used in making coins. These are the uses of copper. Now let us see the next topic, that is isolation of iron. So as we know earlier, in every isolation of a metal, we will be having four steps, that is selection of the ore, concentration of the ore, extraction of the crude metal, and refining of the metal. Here, the ores of iron are hematite, whose formula is Fe2O3, magnetite, Fe3O4, siderite, FeCO3, and copper pyrites, that is FeS2. We are going to extract, isolate iron from hematite. Concentration of hematite. So since it is an oxide ore, heavy ore, hematite is a heavy ore, so we are going to concentrate by using hydraulic washing method So the gang particles present with hematite are lighter gang particles. So by using hydraulic washing method, we are going to remove those lighter gang particles, such that we are going to get concentrated hematite. Concentrated hematite. From the concentrated hematite, we are going to produce crude iron metal, extract crude iron metal. So the concentrated ore is heated in the limited supply of air on the shallow hearth of reverberatory furnace during calcination. Following changes in calcination is done in limited supply of air. So here, since it is an oxide ore, we are subjecting it to calcination. Sulfide ores will be subjected to roasting. So since it is an oxide ore, since it is having some volatile impurities, to remove those volatile impurities, we are subjecting this one to calcination with a limited supply of air. So in this limited supply of air, moisture and volatile impurities are driven out or removed. Non-metallic impurities like sulfur, phosphorus, etc. are removed in the form of their oxides. So when sulfur is reacting with oxygen, sulfur dioxide is produced, which is a gas. Phosphorus reacts with oxygen to produce phosphorus pentoxide, which is also removed in the form of gas or vapors. If any carbonates are present, they will be dissociated or decomposed into oxide and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is also a gas. So generally, iron carbonate is present as one of the impurity here. It is being heated to produce ferrous oxide and carbon dioxide. So all the gases like sulfur dioxide, phosphorus pentoxide, carbon dioxide are in the form of gases. So they leave the reverberatory furnace. Ferrous oxide, whatever ferrous oxides present as impurity or formed here, will be oxidized to ferric oxide, Fe2O3. If iron is if iron is having its oxygen state as +2, then it is ferrous oxide. If the iron is having its oxygen state as +3, then it is ferric oxide. Conversion of iron oxides into crude metal. So here we are using iron oxides because we will be having traces of ferrous oxide, Fe3O4, Fe2O3, like that. So that is why we are using the word oxides. So here we are going to subject this one for smelting, where heat energy is used with a flux to remove the impurities in the form of slag. And a suitable reducing agent is also used to see that we are going to get the crude metal. Here, the powdered ore or the calcinated ore is mixed with limestone and flux. Limestone and flux, in which we are going to see that 8 parts of the ore is taken, 4 parts of fuel and 1 part of flux. So in the ratio of 8:1:4. The blast furnace, it is taken into a blast furnace. The blast furnace is a cylindrical pear shaped steel vessel lined inside with lime. It is having, the blast furnace is having the diameter of 6 meters. On passing preheated compressed air inside the furnace, 4 distinct zones are formed. We'll be forming 4 zones here. So this is the outline structure of a blast furnace, whose highest diameter will be 6 meters. This is made up of iron, where inside it is lined with bricks and lime. The top triangle shaped, this thing is shown here. It is the cup and cone arrangement. which allows the charge to coincide but will not allow anything to come outside. That is to say that it is only an entry, it cannot be a outlet. It is only an inlet, it cannot be a outlet. So that is why this particular is called as cup and cone arrangement. Now let us see how the blast furnace works in detail. As we said here, by passing preheated compressed air inside the blast furnace, this blast furnace automatically divides itself into distinct zones, four distinct zones, four zones. Let us first see about what are those zones. Before going to that, let us remember the Illingham diagram related to iron oxides what we had studied. So here in our previous classes of Illingham diagrams, we had discussed that when the temperature is below 800 degrees centigrade, we are using carbon monoxide as the reducing agent. Above 800 degrees centigrade, we are using carbon as the reducing agent. From the Illingham diagram, we came to know that when an iron oxides, for the reduction of iron oxides, the suitable reducing agent below 800 degrees centigrade is carbon monoxide, whereas above 800 degrees centigrade is carbon is the suitable reducing agent. This is the thing what we had discussed in Illingham diagram of iron. Now in the blast furnace, we are taking the charge.
Charge is
calcined ore, a mixture of calcined ore, coke and lime.
Calcined ore is the ore, coke is the fuel,
and lime is used as the flux here.
So here we are taking
8 parts of calcined ore, 4 parts of coke and 1 part of flux. So the charge is
a calcined ore, coke and
lime in the ratio of 8:4:1.
So this is the
blast furnace. Here the hot air is sent, the preheated hot air is sent through the tires, these are the tires, into the blast furnace. And after sending the hot air, due to few reactions, you can see that the blast furnace is divided into zones. A blast furnace is divided into four zones based upon the temperatures inside that area. So as the hot air is sent, the coke present with the charge is burnt in the presence of oxygen, that is called as combustion, due to which when carbon is burnt in the presence of oxygen, forming carbon dioxide, is an exothermic process, due to which large amount of heat energy is being produced here, which varies from 1900 degrees centigrade to 2200 degrees centigrade. So in the zone of combustion, the temperature must be above 1500 degrees centigrade. Above 1500 degrees centigrade. Above this zone of combustion, we'll be having zone of fusion. So students, I want to remember you, I want to make it clear for you, the word fusion is not related to your radioactive fusion. This is fusion means, the literal meaning of fusion in English, the word fusion means melting. The substance, the liquid substance formed after fusion is called as a fused substance. So here in the zone of fusion, whose temperature ranges from 1200 degrees centigrade to 1300 degrees centigrade, in that particular zone we can see that the metal and the slag formed will be melted or fused. That is why this particular zone is called as zone of fusion. Above that one, that is about 1000 degrees centigrade, we'll be having zone of slag. Zone of slag, where generally slag is formed. And above that, we'll be having zone of reduction, where the temperature ranges from 400 degrees centigrade to 600 degrees centigrade. So these are the four zones in the blast furnace, where we can see that the temperatures, so based upon the temperature range, this blast furnace is divided into four zones: zone of combustion, zone of fusion, zone of slag, and zone of reduction.
So as we had seen the four zones in blast furnace, let us learn about each and every zone particularly present in the zone, blast furnace. So this is the blast furnace, which is a pear shaped. As you know that the highest diameter of the blast furnace is 6 meters, and it is divided into four zones. On the top, you are having a cup and cone arrangement for the release of or inlet of the charge, where this is only an inlet, it cannot be an outlet. So that is why this is called as cup and cone arrangement. And this is the outlet for the blast furnace gases. Whatever gases released, unwanted gases will be left out outside. In this, we are going to learn about tires. Tires means it is the inlet for hot air. Hot air is being blasted through tires like this. As the tires release the hot air, automatically what happens is the coke present in the charge will be burnt in the presence of oxygen to produce carbon dioxide. And this process is an exothermic process, that is to say that a large amount of heat energy is produced. As the heat energy is produced, you can see that in the zone of combustion, the temperature ranges from 1500 degrees centigrade to 2200 degrees centigrade. And the carbon dioxide formed in this zone slowly move upwards, because it is a gas, it is having upward displacement, so due to which carbon dioxide moves into the blast furnace slowly. As this carbon dioxide is moving into the blast furnace slowly, carbon dioxide reacts with the coke present in the charge to produce carbon monoxide. This reaction is an endothermic process. Since this is an endothermic reaction, automatically what happens is, as wherever the carbon dioxide is going, the temperature is getting decreased. So this is the main reaction in which you can see that the temperature goes on decreasing because of formation of carbon monoxide from carbon dioxide, which is an endothermic process. So due to which you can see that the temperature is going on decreasing in the blast furnace. So this reaction is the main reason for the division of blast furnace into zones based on their temperatures. In the blast furnace, we shall see about the next zone. So before going to that, let us remember about the charge. Charge is the mixture of calcined ore, coke, and limestone. So calcined ore is the ore, coke is the fuel, and limestone is the flux. We are going to take in 8:4:1 ratio, that is 8 parts of calcined ore, 4 parts of coke, which is the fuel, and 1 part of limestone, which is used as the flux. So in the blast furnace, we can see that we are speaking about the zone of reduction. So here, this is the top range of temperature zone here, in which the temperature is ranging from 400 degrees centigrade to 600 degrees centigrade. Here, according to the Illingham diagrams, we had observed that when the temperature is below 800 degrees centigrade, for the oxides of iron, carbon monoxide is going to be the reducing agent. So that is why Fe2O3 ferric oxide, when it is reduced with the carbon monoxide, iron is produced. If any traces of Fe3O4 is present in the charge, it also will be reacted with the carbon monoxide to produce a ferrous oxide, FeO. But here, since you know that according to the Illingham diagrams, there is a temperature range difference between ferrous oxide and ferric oxide. Ferrous oxide will be reduced at 600 degrees centigrade by using carbon monoxide. But the main point you have to remember is below 800 degrees centigrade, iron oxides can be reduced by using carbon monoxide to produce iron metal. So in zone of reduction, we can see that we are able to produce iron from oxides of iron below 800 degrees centigrade. That is to say that at 400 degrees centigrade, ferric oxide will be converted to iron by reducing with carbon monoxide. If any traces of Fe3O4 is present in the charge, it is getting reacted with carbon monoxide to produce ferrous oxide. And ferrous oxide will be reacting with carbon monoxide to produce iron at 600 degrees centigrade. So in this way, in the zone of reduction, you can see that iron metal is being produced from its oxides.
Next, let us see zone of slag. In zone of slag, you can see that it is about, the temperature is maintained around 1000 degrees centigrade. Here, the flux what we are taking as CaCO3, calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate directly will not use as flux. At high temperature of 1000 degrees centigrade, this calcium carbonate will be converted into calcium oxide. That calcium oxide reacts with the gangue, that is the silica, to produce calcium silicate. So here, calcium oxide is the flux which is basic in nature, whereas the silica is the gangue which is acidic in nature. So acidic gangue is removed by using basic flux. So here calcium oxide is the basic flux and silica is the acidic, calcium oxide is the basic flux and silica is the acidic gangue. Such that we are producing calcium silicate, which is the slag. Then the next zone, that is zone of fusion. As I said earlier, fusion means solid converting into liquid by heating. So in this zone, actually we had to see that whatever metal we had formed in a reduction zone and slag formed in slag zone must be fused or converted into liquid form in this particular zone. But there is a chance of presence of iron oxides in the substance formed. So that iron oxide will be reacting with the coke, because here the temperature is from 1200 degrees centigrade to 1300 degrees centigrade. So according to Illingham diagram, above 800 degrees centigrade, carbon will be the suitable reducing agent. Carbon will be the suitable reducing agent. So ferric oxide, if any ferric oxide is left over, that will be reduced by using carbon to produce iron. So in zone of fusion, whatever crude iron formed and the slag formed will be fused, that is converted into liquid. In this process, the iron formed will be in the form of molten. That is why it is called as molten iron or fused iron. Iron is heavy and the slag is having less density. So the less denser slag will be separated and hot metal, molten iron, will be separated in this zone. So we had explained about the four zones what we are having in the blast furnace, that is combustion zone, reduction zone, zone of slag and zone of fusion.
So in the blast furnace, you can see that we are taking the charge, that is calcined ore, coke and limestone, in the ratio of 8:4:1. You know that the blast furnace is divided into four zones based upon the temperature ranges. In the zone of combustion, you can see that coke is reacting with oxygen to, burnt in the presence of oxygen to produce carbon dioxide, which is an exothermic process. Carbon dioxide having the upward displacement will be moving to the top of the carbon dioxide through the blast furnace, which is reacting with the coke to produce carbon monoxide, which is an endothermic process. Due to the endothermic process, you can see that the temperature is being decreased in the blast furnace. As the carbon dioxide is moving to the top, from the bottom to the top, you can see that the carbon dioxide, the temperature ranges are being decreased. So that is where you can see that the blast furnace is divided into different temperature ranges. And then in zone of reduction, you can see that ferric oxide is reacting with carbon monoxide to, I mean, carbon monoxide is reducing ferric oxide to produce iron. If any traces of Fe3O4 is present, it is also reacting with carbon monoxide to produce ferrous oxide here. And this happens at 400 degrees centigrade. And at 600 degrees centigrade, the ferrous oxide formed will be reduced by carbon monoxide to iron. These reactions going on in zone of reduction is based upon Illingham diagram. According to Illingham diagram, you can see that when the temperature is less than 800 degrees centigrade, carbon monoxide is going to be the best reducing agent. Then in zone of slag, you can see that the calcium carbonate is being converted into calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. Now calcium oxide is acting as the basic flux, reacting with the acidic gang, that is silica, to produce calcium silicate. And in zone of fusion, you can see that if any traces of ferric oxide present, it is being reduced by using carbon, because the temperature is more than 800 degrees centigrade. Here, carbon is reducing ferric oxide to iron. And here, whatever crude iron produced and slag produced will be converted into molten state. So molten iron is being produced. This is at a zone of fusion. So now let us see how the blast furnace works.
Introduction of charge. The charge is introduced into the furnace through cup and cone arrangement.
So from the top,
introduction of hot blast.
You can see that
simultaneously, a hot blast of air is introduced into the furnace through the 2 ears.
Blast of hot air is sent.
Combustion of coke.
You can see that
coke present in the charge burns in the hot air, producing carbon dioxide, generating more heat.
This is an exothermic process.
Production of carbon monoxide, the reducing agent.
Up into the blast,
the carbon dioxide formed rises up and reacts with the incoming coke, forming carbon monoxide.
Now,
reduction of hematite.
Zone of reduction,
carbon monoxide formed is a powerful reducing agent. It reduces hematite to iron. Decomposition of limestone. Due to the heat generated, limestone decomposes, forming calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. Formation of slag. Quicklime, CaO, thus formed, acts as a flux and combines with sand, an acidic impurity, converting it into calcium silicate, an easily fusible mass. This mass is called slag. The iron formed is collected at the bottom of the furnace, and the slag forms a layer on it. It protects the molten iron from oxidation. The iron obtained by this process is called pig iron. It contains carbon as an impurity.
Now, this molten iron produced will be poured into sand molds called as the pigs. The sand molds in which molten iron is poured, they are called as pigs. So that is why the iron produced here is called as pig iron. So in this pig iron, this is also called as a cast iron, pig iron or cast iron. It will be having majorly iron, but 3.1% to 4.5% of carbon, small amount of silicon, sulfur and phosphorus will be the impurities. This particular iron is called as pig iron or cast iron. This is the major source of iron for us. Here we are not, in this particular extraction of iron, will not be having a particular steps of refining of iron metal, but from the pig iron only, how the pig iron is used to convert into
iron which is
useful to us. That is the thing we are going to see here instead of refining. So
the pig iron is having majorly 3.1 to 4.5% of carbon, small amounts of silicon, sulfur and phosphorus as impurities, due to which the pig iron is
hard and brittle. It is hard but brittle. So these impurities like silica, phosphorus and sulfur weakens the steel tremendously. So they must be eliminated or removed. The advantage of wrought iron and steel over pig iron is greatly improved by strength. So wrought iron and steel, these are the major things we are going to get from pig iron. Let us see how. So after slag is removed, now iron is beaten here physically. So slag is removed by puddlings, and then or beating the iron mass and physically removing the slag is forming the wrought iron. So here simply when you are beating the egg in your house, during the beating of the egg you can see that when you are thoroughly mixing, you can see bubbles formed over the surface. In the same way, molten iron with the impurities and a slag, when it is beaten, or the process is called as puddling, you can see that all the impurities are getting onto the surface, which are removed or skimmed off, leaving out the iron which is called as a wrought iron. In this wrought iron you can see that the impurities present will be only carbon here, that is 0.15% to 0.28% of carbon will be present. So the iron with 0.15% to 0.28% is called as wrought iron. It is purest form, which is malleable, fibrous and soft. So you can see the examples I had given you how we are going to use the wrought iron. By seeing these pictures you can remember in how we are going to use wrought iron here. Pig iron cannot be malleable and fibrous, but wrought iron is malleable and fibrous. So malleable means the metal which can be drawn into sheets is called as malleability. So wrought iron is malleable. Now the pig iron is mixed with the limestone and iron ore, going to the open hearth furnace. It is heated to about 871 degrees centigrade. The limestone and the ore form a slag that floats on the surface, which is removed. Impurities including carbon are oxidized into carbon dioxide, float out of the iron into the slag. When that substance is formed, it is called as carbon steel, or simply it is also called as steel. Carbon steel, which is only having percentage of iron as, I mean carbon as 0.15% to 1.5%. This is strength. The carbon steel is having good strength. It is neither hard nor brittle, and which is malleable and ductile. That is, malleability means drawing the metal into sheets. Ductile means drawing the metal into wires. So carbon steel is malleable and ductile. You can see the examples I have shown you how the carbon steel will be there. Please don't confuse with the steel and the stainless steel. Steel means which is having iron having 0.15 to 1.5%. Stainless steel means it is an alloy of iron with chromium and nickel. That is used as a stainless steel. This is a steel which we are using in many purposes, especially in construction and other purposes. Now let us see the quick revision of isolation of iron metal from hematite. The hematite ore is taken, which is having lighter gang particles. It is concentrated by hydraulic washing method to produce concentrated hematite. Removing volatile impurities is done by calcination to produce calcinated Fe2O3, ferric oxide, calcinated ferric oxide. Calcinated ferric oxide is subjected to smelting in the blast furnace, undergoes reduction to produce molten iron. Molten iron is poured into sand containers called as pigs to produce pig iron, which is also called as cast iron. From this cast iron or pig iron, we are producing wrought iron or steel. So this is the quick revision of isolation of iron metal from hematite. And lastly, we are having the uses of cast iron. Cast iron, which is the most important form of iron, is used for casting stoves. Casting stoves, in olden days, people used to use this one. Railway sleepers, gutter pipes. Gutter means the water outlets what we will be having beside the roads. They are called as gutters. Gutter pipes, toys are prepared by using cast iron. It is used in the manufacture of wrought iron and steel. Wrought iron is used for making anchors, wires, bolts, chains and agricultural instruments. So anchors, wires, bolts, chains and agricultural implements are made from wrought iron. Then steel finds a number of uses. Alloy steel is obtained when other metals are added to it. Nickel steel is used for making cables, automobiles, aeroplane parts, pendulums, and measuring tapes. So when steel is combined with nickel, it is called as nickel steel. Nickel steel is used in making of cables, automobiles, aeroplane parts, pendulum, measuring tapes, etc. Chrome steel. So when steel is combined with chromium, then it is called as chrome steel. It is used for cutting tools and crushing machines. So chrome steel is used in manufacture of cutting tools and crushing machines. And stainless steel, which is a alloy of iron, chromium and nickel and carbon, small amount of carbon. This stainless steel is used for cycles, automobiles, utensils, pens, etc. So these are the uses of iron. With this, we came to the end of this chapter, that is general principles and processes in isolation of elements. So today I'll be sending you one assignment on this one. At the same time, I'll be sharing you the questions of PUC, which are likely to be important questions, to say that the questions which had appeared in the previous PUC exams. Both the things I'll be sharing you today, and shortly you'll be having a test on this one. So be prepared for the test. Thank you.